Well, thank you for joining us for Almost Persuaded. My name is Alan Hall. I'm the pastor of Good News Church in York, Pennsylvania. If you have your Bibles today, if you'll turn to the book of 2 Peter, 2 Peter chapter 1. We're going to read several verses there, starting in verse 3. So 2 Peter chapter 1, beginning in verse 3. It says, "According as his divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness, through the knowledge of him that hath called us to glory and virtue, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these ye might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. And beside this, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, and to virtue knowledge, and to knowledge temperance, and to temperance patience, and to patience godliness, and to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness charity. For if these things be in you and abound, they make you that ye shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But he that lacketh these things is blind and cannot see afar off, and hath forgotten that he was purged from his old sins." Here we have some garments, as one, or actually several commentators call these words that Peter gave to us. It's a list of virtues, another one mentioned. But these are things that as Christians, as believers, we need to put on. In other words, these things do not come naturally to us. We are not born with these things. It is only after we establish a relationship with Jesus Christ that God enables us to be able to put these things on in our life. And these things are evidences that you are living for Christ and you're allowing him to live through you. And here we come to the very last virtue, or the very last garment here in this list, found in verse 7. It says, "And to brotherly kindness add charity." Now, another word for charity is love, and that is the garment that we're going to be looking at today. Now, these words, these virtues, of course, are not in this list by accident, nor are the order, neither is the order of the virtues in this list, I believe, by accident. You know, I believe God had a purpose for every word in the Bible and for every order that he put those words in the Bible. And here you have charity or love listed last. Now, it's not listed last because it's the least of the virtues, but rather, I think a better way to look at it is that this word love, this virtue of love, is the last thing that we put on. In other words, it is kind of, imagine you're leaving the house. You've put on your shirt, you've put on your pair of pants or dress or whatever it may be, whatever you're dressing for that occasion, you have those garments on. And then the last thing you do before you leave the house, you might put on a hat, you might straighten a tie, you might put on a coat, you might put on a pair of gloves, but this is the last garment that you would put on. Another way of looking at it is your outfit would not be complete without putting on this virtue or this garment of love. You know, the Apostle Paul reminds us in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, it doesn't matter what else we have, if we don't have love, we have nothing. Now, the word love is a very common word in the English language. I mean, we use it for all kinds of different things. You know, I love the chocolate brownie sundaes that they have at Dairy Queen. You know, I love my pet fish. I love my wife, my children. I love my church. I love my job. You know, whatever it may be, but we just throw that word around in so many different ways and about so many different things that I think we lose the meaning of what love truly is. We use it so often, it kind of becomes a word that we just throw around for anything. And so it's very important here that we find out what Peter's talking about. When he mentions putting on charity or love, you know, what is he describing there? And so let's try to define that. What does he mean to put on love? Now, somebody once said that if you want to know the definition of a word, just ask a child. And I want you to just kind of listen here to what several children had to say to the question, what is love? One kid who had apparently witnessed the marital struggles of his parents said, "Love is that first feeling you feel before all the bad stuff gets in the way." Another child put it this way, "Love is when a girl puts on perfume, and a boy puts on cologne, and they go out and they smell each other. I like this one. Love is what makes you smile at each other, even when you're tired. One little girl said, love is when mommy makes coffee for my daddy, and she takes a sip before giving it to him to make sure that it tastes okay. One observant little girl said, love is when you tell a guy you like his shirt, and then he wears it every day. Well, I like this one a lot. Love is like a little old woman and a little old man who are still friends after, even after they know each other so very well. And here's one more. Love is when mommy sees daddy smelly, sweaty, and still says he is handsomer than Brad Pitt. Well, you know, those insights do help because it kind of simplifies love for us a little bit. But, you know, to fully understand the caliber of love that Peter is talking about here, we must do what we do with the other words that are listed here in this list that Peter gives us. We need to go back to the original language, and that is Koine Greek. And what is the word that Peter uses here for charity? It is the word agape. It is the most supreme form of love. It means unconditional love. And so kind of picture this in your mind. On one end of the spectrum, you have unconditional love, agape love. And then on the other end, you have conditional love, the love that most of us are familiar with. The word love that we use most often. You see, conditional love is based on desire and expectation. It is a love that says, if you're good, I'll love you. You know, if you love me, then I'll love you back. If you please me, then I'll love you. Or if you're beautiful and you remain that way, then I will love you. But agape love is very much different from that love because it doesn't place conditions on that love. It is not a because of kind of love. It is more of an in spite of kind of love. It's a commitment to love even if the one being loved is not beautiful, even if they are not very desirable, even if they are bad, even if they treat us wrongly, even if they don't love us back or they disappoint us, we still love them. That is unconditional love. Mark Buchanan writes this. He says, agape love chooses to love. In the face of betrayal, in the face of rejection, in the face of evasion, in the face of rank badness, it wills to love even when circumstances trigger instincts of anger or hurt, withdrawal or revenge. Agape is an unprovoked love. You see, agape love seeks those who never saw it coming, and even those who never really had it coming. It shows up unannounced, unexpected, and completely undeserved. It isn't based on beauty. It isn't based on popularity. It isn't based on intelligence or even worthiness. It is the way that God loves us. You see, you and I are so unworthy of God's love, but yet He loves us anyway. And as His children, God wants us to have that same kind of love toward others and, of course, toward Him. And so we must learn this. Again, this does not come naturally to us. We must learn to put on agape love. Now, how do we go about doing that? Well, what would be the proof to us? If we were to examine our life today and we'd say, I wonder if I do display that kind of love. What would be the proof that would show us that we actually do give this to one another and to God? Well, let me just share with you today three groups of people that we must learn to love. And if we can examine our life today and we say, you know what, I truly do love that group of people, and I love that group of people and that group of people, that is going to be proof to us that we are wearing agape love. So let me just give you those three groups. The first group is are these. We must learn to love the least of these. Now, who are the least of these? These are the people who are most likely not to be noticed. In other words, you can go right past them and you don't even see them. They are the ones that kind of blend in many times. They are the physically handicapped. They are the person or people that have an unusual quirk about them. The not so popular, the not so athletic, the not so talented. They are the overweight or the underweight. These are those that maybe talk differently or dress differently or act differently or look differently. These are the ones that either stick out like a sore thumb or they blend in with the wallpaper. Many times they are the shy. They're the misunderstood. Sometimes they are the troublemakers in the group. For whatever reason, they just don't fit in to our world that we've, you know, kind of created for ourselves. They're not in our circle of friends. They are what one has described the losers and the loners and the outcast of life. They are the people that we tend to ignore, even if we notice that they're there. You know, many times we pretend that they're not there. We look the other way so that we don't have to be confronted with whatever is going on with them. You know, we probably can remember people that fit into these groups from maybe high school, our high school days. You know, maybe perhaps you were in one of these groups that I just mentioned. And our minds tend to immediately go to that time in our life because it's during that time, our high school days, that, you know, kids can be so cruel to people. They can put labels on people. They can put people in particular categories and even make fun of people who don't, you know, look and act like them. You know, I was asked several years ago, if I could go back to high school, what would I change? And it didn't take me very long to come up with an answer to that because I've actually given a considerable amount of thought to that before. You know, because if I could go back to high school knowing what I know now, I would go back and be a friend to those who didn't have very many friends. I would go back and take the time and invest time into those folks that, you know, a lot of folks, including myself, overlooked and pretended many times that they were not there. You know, instead of trying to impress people, you know, as all of us did in high school, we tried to impress that certain crowd. We tried to fit into a certain crowd. We tried to, you know, we were so worried about what they thought of us. You know, I would lay all that to the side and forget about all that and just try to spend time with those that just needed a friend. You know, agape love pushes us beyond ourselves, doesn't it? And it allows us to see those that we tend to usually ignore. You know, our greatest example, as always, is Jesus Christ. And I think of a couple of times we have recorded in God's Word that this happened. You remember when he went to the temple and he drove the money changers out? That actually happened two times during his ministry here on earth. One of those was at the beginning of his ministry. One was toward the end of his ministry. And he goes in and he sees the money table or money changers tables there and them sitting there. And he drives them out. He takes a whip and he drives those individuals out and he overturns the table. And he's angry at what is taking place there. Now, of course, we know that he was angry and he does what the Bible teaches, that we can be angry and sin not. This was righteous anger here. And so he drives these individuals out. Now, what made him so upset? Why did he, you know, get so out of, you know, just so aggravated at these individuals and overturn the tables and drive them out? Why did he do that? Because they had set up their money-changing tables in the outer court. Now, what was the outer court? The outer court of the temple was reserved for those who were not allowed to go any further into the temple. These were the Gentiles. These were the outcast of society, even some of the Jews who were labeled as outcasts. This was the closest they could come to God, and these money changers had taken that away from them. They were taking up their space. And Jesus said, no, that cannot be. It says in Mark chapter 11, verse 17, he said, my house will be called a house of prayer for all nations. My house, the temple, God's place that we associate God's dwelling is for everybody. It's just not for a specific few. Now, if we're to become like Jesus, we've got to learn to love this same group of people that Jesus loved. You know, you find that throughout his ministry where he took up time with those that were on the outskirts, the outcasts, the people that no one wanted to have anything to do with. You know, the lepers, those that were caught up in adultery, the publicans. You know, he was accused of eating with sinners. Now, isn't that something that would be held as an accusation against Jesus? Oh, he loves sinners. Well, I'm glad that he does, because he loves you and me, and we are definitely sinners. I heard a story, a true story, in fact, in Brooklyn, New York, there's a school for kids with learning disabilities. And there was, a few years ago, there was a dad of one of those students, a child that was handicapped pretty severely mentally, and it, of course, carried over to his body as well. This dad was asked to speak at a fundraising dinner that they were holding there for the school. And so he stood up that day, and of course he had most everyone's attention as he thanked this one, and he thanked that one, and this one over there, and you know, everybody was okay. And then he began to say some things that really caught people off guard that day. He said, "I've got a question." He said, "Where is the perfection for my son, Shia?" He said, "Everything done in heaven is done with perfection, but my child cannot understand things as other children. Where is the perfection in that?" And as everyone sat in kind of a stunned silence, he continued. He said, "I believe that when heaven brings a child like this, like my son, into this world, the perfection it seeks is found in the way other people react to this child." And then he went on to tell this story. He said, "My son Shia and I were at a ballpark one day, and we were watching some boys play softball. And it wasn't an organized game. It was kind of like a pickup game that they had put together. And they had the two teams going there. And we were watching, enjoying the game. And Shia says to me, 'Dad, I want to play.'" And I knew they would never have picked Shia for one of the teams, you know. And you know, he's too slow and, you know, and not able to do the things the other kids is doing. But I went out and I talked to one of the pitchers there. And I pleaded with him, "Please let my son play. Can you put him in the game for just a little while? He really wants to play." And the pitcher thought about it for a moment and he said, "Okay, you know, we'll let him play. We'll put him in. We'll put him in a place, you know, that you know, he'll be okay as far as fielding, and we'll let him bat the ninth. I mean, what did we have to lose? I mean, we're down 6 runs anyway." And so they put Shia in, and Shia couldn't believe it, and he was overjoyed, and he's clapping his hands, and he makes his way out to short center field, and of course he's got those around him there to help take care of him, and he was just, I mean, grinning from ear to ear. Well, as the game went on, I mean, they were in the 8th inning when he went in, and then they went into the 9th. His team actually got within striking distance of going ahead. Matter of fact, in the 9th inning, they had the bases loaded, and they were only 2 runs down. And guess whose turn it was up to bat? Shia's. Well, the pitcher called the team over, and, you know, they began to discuss, you know, what they were going to do. And they said, "Well, you know, let's let him hit." To the daddy's surprise, they went over, they grabbed the bat, and they gave it to Shia. And Shia went to home plate and took his position there. And you could tell it was an awkward position for him. He really didn't know how to bat, and he was holding the bat wrong, and he was holding it back too tight. But then the pitcher did something that was unexpected. He took a couple steps closer to home, and he just kind of lobbed the ball across the plate. Perfect pitch to hit. And Shia, with holding the bat so awkwardly, saw the pitch coming, and he swung with everything that he had, and he missed. And so they picked the ball up, they threw it back to the pitcher, and they said, "No, that's all right, that's all right." And his teammates were encouraging him, and one of his teammates came out, and he went up behind Shia, and he wrapped his arms around him, and both of them took the bat with their hands. And the player said to Shia, he said, "Let's hit it together." So once again, the pitcher just lobbed a perfect pitch across the plate. And this time they bunted the ball. The ball rolled right to the pitcher. The pitcher could have picked it up easily and thrown Shia out. Everybody went to screaming at Shia, "Run to first, run to first." And of course his run was barely even a trot. I mean, it was so slow getting there. And again, the pitcher could have thrown him out, but the pitcher threw it wide left, right in the right field. And so he made it to first. And while they're getting the ball out of right field, his teammates are screaming to him, "Run to second, run to second." And so again, very slowly, he makes his way to second, and the right fielder picks up the ball, and he too throws it wide of the base, and it goes into left field. And so then he made it to second, and they went to screaming, make it to third, go to third, run to third. And of course, he made it to third. All the rest of the ones that were on his team had already made it. Those who were on base had made it to home, and they were waiting for Shia. Now, by this time, everybody that's standing around looking in the stands, and both teams even, are screaming at Shia, run home, run home. And as he slowly made his way home, his foot finally hit home plate. And as he did, the softball came singing behind his head. He was safe. They took Shia and they lifted him up on their shoulders, and they began jumping up and down and chanting his name and treated him like a hero that day. The dad at the dinner said, on that day, those 18 boys reached their level of heaven's perfection. You know what? I think I know what he was saying that day. He was saying that those boys chose to love one of the least of these. Well, let me ask you today, who are the least of these in your life that God has placed along the path, that you walk on each day? Who are the people who are the easiest for you to avoid? You know, we'll never become more like Jesus until we learn to love the least of these. The second group I want to mention is the most of these. You know, agape love causes us to take a step further. Agape love says not only love the least of these, but also the most of these. These are not the losers in life. These are the winners of life. This is love for the person who sings, anything you can do, I can do better. And they can. They always somehow edge you out. They come out ahead of you. It's having a love for those that you're most likely to notice, that you're most likely to resent for being so successful. These are your rivals. It's your prettier sister. It's your more athletic brother. It's the guy at work who gets the promotions and gets the pay raises before you do. It's the perfect mom that you know of that always, you know, has her kids so dressed and their house so well kept, and it seems like she doesn't have a problem in the world. You know, it's that guy that always edges you out in some way that you're in competition with. You know, agape love helps us overcome that inborn jealousy that's there, that resentment for these kind of people. And it takes away those feelings of inferiority and insecurity. It's the love that enables us to be our biggest rival's biggest fan. It's the kind of love that we see in the Old Testament that Jonathan had for David. You remember, Jonathan was supposed to be next in line to be king, but he actually helped David to be safe and to take steps closer to taking the crown. So who are the most of these in your life? You know, if you're going to ever have agape love for them, you got to ask yourself, what's God doing in their life? Why does He allow them to come out on top, to get the promotion, to be so successful? And then, God, help me to pray for them. How can I be a part of this? Help me to love and encourage them. The only way you can ask those questions is by putting on agape love. And then thirdly, we must learn to love the worst of these. In other words, to love as God loves, we must love our enemies. And I'm going to tell you, this is something that we have to ask God's help to do. Because these are the people that we're least likely to like. I'm talking about the person who's betrayed you, the person that's hurt you, the person that's talked bad about you, the person that's taken something from you, or maybe even tried to destroy you. This, again, is where we need God the most. I mean, we have to have His help and His strength to do this. Because our inclination is to kind of hate these kind of people, to dislike. These are the people that we tend to want vengeance for. That we say to God, God, you get them and you get them good. You know, rain fire and brimstone down on them. Agape love loves these folks instead. You know, Jesus gave us this command in Matthew 5:43. He said, love your enemies. Bless them that curse you. Do good to them that hate you. And pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you, that ye may be children of your Father which is in heaven. Years ago, there was a woman from Rwanda whose son was killed. This grieving mother was consumed with hate and bitterness toward her son's killer, and she constantly prayed, God, reveal to me my son's killer. One night she dreamed a dream. She was going to heaven. But there was something that she had to do in order to get there. She had to walk down the street and enter the front door of her certain house. She had to go through its rooms and exit the back door. And in her dream, she asked God, she didn't recognize the house, she asked God, "Whose house is this?" And God told her it was the house of her son's killer. She realized that the road to heaven passed through the house of her enemy. She couldn't get that dream off her mind. Well, 2 days later, there was a knock at her door. She opened her door, and there stood a young man. He was about her son's age. And she asked him what he wanted. He hesitated, and this is what he said. He said, "I am the one who killed your son. Since that day, I have had no life, no peace. So here I am. I'm placing my life in your hands. If you want to kill me, go ahead and kill me. I'm already dead anyway. Throw me in jail. I'm in prison already. Torture me. I'm in torment already. Do with me as you wish." The woman had prayed for this opportunity, and she had wanted to kill him. She had wanted to throw him in jail. She wanted to torture him. But in that moment, she wondered what she would do. She didn't do any of those things. What she did was remarkable. She said to this young man who killed her son, standing outside her door, "This is what I ask of you. Come into my home. I want you to come and live with me. I want you to eat the food that I would have prepared for my son. I want you to wear the clothes that I would have made for my son. I want you to become the son that I lost." And so he did. You know, that is an amazing story, but what was she doing? She was practicing agape love. She was reflecting God's love toward the worst of these in her life. She was loving the same way God loved us. You know, when did God choose to love us? Did he wait until we got everything straight in our life? Did he wait to see if our commitment to him was going to be really real? Did he wait to see if how sorry we were for our sins first? You know, the Bible says that he loved us long before any of those things. He commended his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. He gave his son for his enemies, you and me. And so as I close out this message today, let me just ask you, what is God's love compelling you to do? Is there a least of these in your life? Or most of these, or even a worst of these, that God has brought to mind, your mind today, as I've been giving this message. You know, I ask for you just to go before God and say, "God, help me to see people as you see them. You love me with agape love. Now help me to love others. Help me to get over the bitterness. Help me to get over the resentment. Help me to get over the bad feelings toward people. And God, don't let me overlook anybody. Open my eyes to a world that needs for me to show and display and give agape love to them. Lord, help me to put on this garment of love for you."